Hello?
Oh. We do have sound. So, welcome to my presentation about the MBS FileMaker plugin. My name is Christian Schmitz. I'm from Germany and I apologize for my accent. So, for the last 10 years, I'm developing a FileMaker plugin which got over the years 4,000 functions. That's a lot of stuff. And probably all the problems you may have someone else had before, so we got a new plugin function for that. Last year we got over 600 new functions, this year already over 500. People are still asking for more, so I'm adding more and more. We have 400 example projects. If you want to check out those examples, it may be good to take a week off. It's 50 a day, you need 8 days. To keep installation easy and the management of the plugin easy for me, I decided 10 years ago to just make one plugin file. So it's one file you drag into the extension folder, or one file to install, to update. We support FileMaker 8.5 and newer, up to the latest version 15, and of course, if you are in some testing, the future version. We support Mac and Windows, and probably very soon more platforms. I'm already compiling all the day my libraries for different platforms. We support FileMaker Pro, Advanced, Server, Web, Direct, and Runtime. Also custom web publishing, of course. Currently everything except Go. One of the decisions 10 years ago was to make only one function in FileMaker, so the regulation dialog is not filled with 4,000 functions, but just with one. And the first parameter is the function name. This allows you to take the function name from a calculation or from a field. Some people even decided to not write a script, but put all the commands into records into a database and then have a script going over those records to execute it. A lot of functions may return an error if something's going wrong, and the function isError will tell you if the last function returned an error or not. This way you can write clear scripts which don't rely on parsing the result of the last function. Cool. We have a lot of functions using reference parameters. So you call one function, you get back a number, and you call the next function and you pass a number. This way we can have several transactions open for SQL databases or several connections to a network. I don't want to tell you what's new over 10 years, I just limit myself to the last 2 years. So, we have a lot of network functions, and we recently got LDAP support, so you can query your LDAP server, manage your users, groups, permissions there, and then FileMaker can, of course, use those settings for login, so you can manage your LDAP server in FileMaker. You can also look up via the DNS for IPs and domains. And if you need a network transfer, we have the curl library on hand. So for anything with HTTP, FTP, SFTP, IMAP, POP3, SMTP, and a couple more protocols, we can use our plugin. We have SSL and SSH libraries available as part of the plugin. No extra install for that, so you can do your secure uploads if you need. The plugin allows to do a transfer synchronously, so your script is waiting for the transfer to finish, or you can run it in the background, so we don't block anything in FileMaker, so the user interface is not blocked while we do upload or download, and we can run transfers asynchronously in the background, which allows us to very efficiently run hundreds of requests parallel. Like if you're sending emails in batch mode, you may want to have 100 connections in parallel for uploading emails. You can get the result of a transfer. Of course, you can. If you download a picture, you can get it as a picture, as a container value, you can get your result as text. Or if you're downloading an email from an email server, you can get the result passed as an email. And we have a couple of options for proxies, for security, for authentication, and also for keeping alive a connection if the internet connection is over satellite and very slow. Our plugin contains an email parser, which allows you to parse the content of an email as you got it from a POP3 or IMAP server. You can get all the text, the HTML, all the attachments. You can store the attachments to file or to container. You can convert the HTML to text if needed, and store the text of the email for later searching it. Our plugin has a lot of PDF features. Those features are split into two parts. One is the PDF kit features, which is only for Mac. The other part is the Dyna PDF feature set, which is requiring an extra license from us, because that's a third-party C library. We need to sub-license. But it allows you to use PDF features cross-platform on Mac and Windows. This includes creating PDFs, editing existing PDFs, merging and splitting PDFs, and of course rendering preview pictures, like thumbnails. You can embed any file into a PDF. So PDF has a type of attachment. We use that in Germany for invoices, where the invoice has a visible part, the PDF you can see and print, and has embedded XML file with all the data for the computer to use. You can convert existing PDFs to PDF-A standard if you need to archive your PDFs. We can send a PDF to printer both on Mac and Windows, on Mac using PDF kit, on Windows using Dyna PDF, so you can automatically print even on the server if you need. And of course we can create PDFs on the server. That means not from the layout you provide, but by script commands. And we have a couple of examples which I can show you later for that, and how to build a PDF on a server. And we can optimize PDF files. This means we can recreate the structure of the PDF and normally produce an error-correct PDF which is smaller in size. In addition, we can scale down all the images and compress them to JPEG pictures. This way the PDF gets much smaller usually, especially if you just want the PDF for emailing and not for printing on a poster. We can replace duplicates for any resource in the PDF with references, which allows us to remove duplicate fonts or duplicate images. Like if you merge two PDF documents which use the same picture for a logo, we can replace those with a reference and the resulting PDF is smaller. And we can remove private data. Like if you make a PDF from InDesign, it will embed for images the original image as a copy. So you have the image to display and the image for InDesign to edit, and we can remove those extra data blocks. If you're interested in signing data, we have elliptic curve digital signatures. So you can sign a block of data with your public key or private key, and then later check again if with a, so you can sign with a private key and then with a public key or the private key you can verify the signature and see if your data was modified. We do offer a dictionary functionality. That's an associative array in memory which you can use to do quick lookups for anything in your solution. I once had a customer using that to look up the display text for a record, and he's using UIDs for all the record IDs. So whenever he finds an ID, he can just ask his dictionary what's the name for this UID and then display that. And you can easily fill the dictionary with a SQL command, so like going over all the tables, loading the UID and the display text, one of the fields, into the dictionary and later use that for lookup. Of course, that also works with our JSON functions, and you can of course store them serialized. We have a lot of clipboard functions. So in FileMaker, you can put something on the clipboard if you go to a field. We can do that without a field. And we can do it for RTF, for HTML, we can do it for file references. For example, your user can go on the Finder or on the Explorer and select a couple of files, and then you can use a plugin function to query the path for those files. In a recent version, we also got support for getting and setting pictures on the clipboard. And we have a couple of functions to work with Word files. So you can open a Word file, you can replace some text with actual values, and then store the Word file on disk again. Some people use that for batch creating Word files. Normally I would prefer to use PDF. PDF, but some people have a Word-based workflow. We got a feature to record video and audio in the plugin, so if you need to record snippets from the camera on your Mac or PC, you can record to a file. You can store that file in your database, of course, and you can select which audio device or video device to use, and you can show a preview of the video in your layout. That's really handy because FileMaker dropped that feature when they dropped QuickTime support. We also have a couple of functions on Mac to use frameworks from Apple to detect content of video files. Like we can create details on the video files, metadata, lyrics, whatever. We can generate images for previews. So if you have a media database and you want to show previews of your movie files, you can show that. We also have a couple of address book functions for Mac. So you can query the system address book. Some people use that to create a group in the address book where they export all their contacts from the database to the address book. And then if one of the clients is calling, they see the name on the iPhone. Because the address book is synced to the iPhone, they can get to the addresses. You can also get notifications if something has changed in the address book, so you can update your database to match the address book content. We got an event monitor feature which helps to detect if the last mouse click was a left mouse or right mouse button. Because a few people like to trigger a script with a button, and depending on if it's a left click or a right click, do different things. Like with right-click, show context to a menu. The plugin can query a couple of internal things from FileMaker, like if you have a value in a variable or field, we can actually detect the type, so you can see if it's a date or just a text with a date as a content. You can get the list of all the scripts, and we can generate your database design report automatically. So you can run a plugin command which will then trigger the menu command to write a design report. The plugin has a lot of functionality for SQL commands within FileMaker. We have a couple of insert, delete, update methods which are easy to use. Yes?
Script steps that do that, so why, what was the benefit of this versus the script step for getting type of value?
Script step. Our plugin provides a function, so you can use it anywhere you like. It's just a convenience thing. Yeah. Some commands in the plugins are duplicates of what FileMaker offers as a script step, but we allow you to call it as a function, so you can use it everywhere. Like FileMaker has a speak script step, but the plugin has a speak function, so we can speak anywhere, even on Windows. A FileMaker script step doesn't work. So on SQL, you may want to use the insert command from the plugin, for example, to insert a record in a table on a different layout without switching to that layout. Same for update or delete. We also have the possibility to insert record via query, so we can make a query in one table and insert all the records in the different table. This preserves the original type of the field, so containers are transferred as containers, and you're not losing anything, as if you would export it to a text file and import back. So the plugin allows you to easily copy from one table to another table, from one table to the same table, or from one table in one file to the table in a different file. And we can create records automatically from tab return text. So if you have a block of text, for example, you copy something in Excel in the clipboard, you go to FileMaker, you can use our plugin command to insert the data in a table. We also offer SQL to other databases. We have a long list of supported databases, including here Oracle, Microsoft SQL, and others. You can do that with a script. So you have plugin functions to connect to a database, connect a function to start a SQL command, to fill the parameters, to execute it, to query the result set, go over all the records you got, and process them. And we connect for native drivers. So we can connect to MySQL without ODBC. We can connect to Microsoft SQL Server, former Mac, without an ODBC driver. Yeah. So for this feature, we added last year the support for SQLite. Well, we had SQLite before, but we added the support for encrypted SQLite databases and full text search, so you can use our plugin to read and write SQLite databases, which are sometimes used by other software you may have to talk to. We can copy records to FileMaker, so we make a SQL command on the other database, we select some fields from a table, and then we can go over that result and insert them directly into a FileMaker database with just one line of code, one line in your script. And of course, you can just make a record query on the foreign database and get back the result as a list or just a text block. Yeah?
Can you trigger procedures on Oracle?
Yes. We can run stored procedures on all the databases. No problem. It's sometimes just a little bit tricky to get the parameters right. Different database vendors have different ways to call stored procedures. So, but if the syntax is correct, it should work. We can schedule a script, a SQL command on evaluation at a certain time, in a certain time, at a certain time of the day, or when the user is idle. So you can have a script running 2 minutes after the user stopped touching the mouse or the keyboard. You can run a script in 5 seconds, or you can run a script tomorrow at 3 o'clock, whatever you like. And you can, using a lot of commands, query the schedules and also cancel them if needed or modify them.
Are these running in the background so that you're not captive in the loop?
We trigger normal FileMaker scripts. So, of course, if a FileMaker is busy doing something, the script will have to wait, because all the scripts we trigger from the plugin execute when FileMaker is not busy.
Does it work like a content or something external to FileMaker?
Yeah, the
plugin can. Activate an event that does not require FileMaker's attention while it's waiting for whatever that event.
No, the plugin is keeps a table with all the schedules and takes a look on the clock every second and sees if there's something to do. That's in the background. You won't notice it.
Okay, that's the key thing. It's running in the background.
Yeah.
Does not require FileMaker's immediate attention. FileMaker is probably single threaded, so.
Yes. We offer, for Mac, we offer file system events, so you can query if something changed in the file system for a certain folder or the whole disk. This can even go backwards in time, so you can ask what changed since the last time my solution was open. This way you can, for example, monitor your folder with external container files and see if the user modified them while your solution was not running. We have a lot of file functions available, like copying files, moving files, renaming files, getting a file comment, setting a file label, whatever. Yes.
Create folder.
Yeah, of course.
And what are any kind of rights management or?
Yeah, you can set permissions.
Yeah, because like in Windows, often that's something.
Windows, it's a little bit more difficult.
Yeah.
Can look into that. So for FileMaker server, we always have the question why we can't write on the mounted disk volume. The usual answer is the disk volume was mounted just for the admin on this computer, not for the FileMaker server. So we got a mount command in the plugin. So the FileMaker server can mount using the plugin his own instance of the network drive, and you can write on it and then unmount it with the plugin. You can query disk information. This includes the number of free bytes on the disk, so your server can check every hour if the disk is full and send you an email if you have to buy a larger hard disk. You can, of course, also check if a file is in use, which is very useful as FileMaker, so you can determine if a database file is open, because the plugin will tell you. And when the file is open and in use by FileMaker, you can't backup it by copying it. And we can, of course, find standard folders like the trash, the desktop, the movies, the downloads folder, whatever. We have a way to define hotkeys. So you can trigger a script on a key down of a certain keyboard key combination. Like I used to have a customer, they pressed the F5 key in the mail application. Then the script would go, would start in FileMaker, would grab by AppleScript the content of the email, bring FileMaker to the front, parse the email, and create records for the email, for an order, for example. Can define various key combinations. Of course, you should take a key combination which is not used by any other application. One customer had on Windows defined F1 to be the key combination, and then every time the user pressed F1, the script would run, but Word would in the background open the help. Okay, we have a lot of functions to create and parse JSON, and those functions are optimized for speed. So I expect them to be quite fast for you. You use JSON, either you pass JSON to the function as a block of JSON text, or you let the plugin once parse the JSON and then pass the reference number to query details on this JSON block, which is faster than parsing it for each function call. You can set and get values by pass, so you can say in this big JSON block, find the entry name people, get the fifth record, get me the first name. This is very convenient if you write a script to import JSON and create records. But the plugin also can use JSON and XML text, parse it, create the required tables and fields in FileMaker, and import all the values. This is a feature which made a lot of people happy, especially one customer in Germany who got a 250,000 address records each month as XML and just drops them in a script which in 10 lines imports all the records without writing an XLST or anything else. JavaScript. The plugin has a couple of functions to run JavaScript in a web viewer, but we also have JavaScript without a web viewer. So some people use it on FileMaker server, for example, to calculate some hashes for web services where they got a JavaScript snippet to calculate it, and now they can calculate it on the server without web viewer and do the web service. Of course, you can also use that to process JSON very efficiently, as JSON is a from JavaScript. Next, sockets. If you need lower level socket support, you may not want to use the curl functions, but our sockets functions. We offer TCP and UDP sockets, so you can offer a TCP socket to listen for incoming connections. You can use a TCP socket to connect to a server, so you can have one FileMaker connect to another FileMaker using our plugin. You can use UDP sockets to send messages to all the computers in the network. This is very useful to build a chat feature in your software. And we can now use IPv6 if you need, in addition to IPv4. The plugin offers a couple of syntax highlighting features for the Mac version of FileMaker. So in most lists you see in the FileMaker user interface, the plugin provides a contextual menu command to copy the content of the list. So if you need to copy a list of all your fields in a table or from your permissions, you can do that. We also highlight we have a large set of rules to color script steps, to highlight, for example, a program script step in red. And if you click on the if or loop part, well, on the script step part of a loop or if construction, it will highlight the other parts of this block. You can also search the scripts and the relationship graph. You can go to a certain line, and if you're still using FileMaker 11, the plugin adds line numbers for you. This is a feature for the if highlighting. So if you click on a line, we will highlight the other lines. Also, if you're doing a presentation on a projector, we can change the color of the selected line in the script editor. So if you need a darker color there instead of the light blue, you can have that.
How do you implement that?
Technically?
Plugin?
Yeah, my plugin, FileMaker is using a standard table control from Apple to write the script workspace. The plugin just registered as a callback there to be notified whenever a line is about to draw. Well, it's on by default, but we have a couple of plugin commands to change things, to turn it on or off. So by just installing the plugin on the Mac, you get the colors. So I know. On Windows, FileMaker uses custom controls, and I can't modify those. Next, a few text functions. Sometimes you have Unicode characters which can be represented in several ways. Like, for example, here on the first example, A. In Germany, you can write an A as one character or as a combination of two characters. The plugin can convert between those representations, because sometimes you have data which uses the representation with several characters, which makes your search fail because your search is maybe looking for an A but not for an R with two dots. And we can detect invalid characters for an encoding. So if you want to use a plugin to write a text file in Windows NZ encoding, we can tell you upfront if there are any characters in your text which wouldn't survive the transform. Also, if you import text with the wrong encoding, we can fix that. So if you tell us that a certain text has been imported, like here, UTF-8 text has been imported as MacRoman, we can go and fix that by converting backwards. The plugin also has a lot of window functions, including, for example, disabling the close button on a window. And we can fade windows in and out, so you can smoothly have them fade away. You can, of course, create the current window or dialog and see, well, in a script, decide what to do depending if FileMaker is currently showing dialog, and you may not do certain things. You can also hide the title bar, modify the toolbar. We got an event framework for Mac, which allows you to create events and reminders on the Mac's database from the calendar app. Yeah. We have newer functions for 64-bit and iOS, and older functions for 32-bit and 64-bit. So you can decide. We also offer RSA encryption, so you can create a private key with the plugin, extract the public key, you can encrypt some data, decrypt it later, or you can sign data and verify the signature later. Some people need that to encrypt data which is then transferred to website and decrypted there. And we have, of course, a lot of little things which I may not mention. For example, we can modify the print dialog on Mac and select a certain printer or a tray, or not show the dialog at all. We can query the command line parameters, environment variables. We can serialize data structures we have in memory and restore them. We can use the Windows management instrumentation to query details about your Windows computer, like what hard disks do you have, what CPU, what serial ports, what antivirus utility, what operating system. You can query a lot there. And we can zip, unzip files, and we got some handy functions there to unzip an archive, for example, and put all the files in the archive into a certain folder, or other way around, archive them. We do have a website where you can read more. There's a page for videos and one for blog. On the blog, I regularly post about new releases and give tips and tricks about using the plugin. And there's a mailing list which you can subscribe to get updates on what's happening. So now I want to show you a few features. Now let's start with PDF. Let's say I have a little database here in FileMaker. And I drop in a few pictures. So here's a beer, a lake, and a castle. And now I generate a PDF file. So the PDF file has a size. It's 10 megabytes on disk. So here's my optimized example. Let's drop in our new file, click on optimize, and the resulting PDF is about 90% smaller. To show you the script, so we initialize our DynaPDF library, we start a new DynaPDF environment, we get back our reference number. Next line, we call open PDF from container, passing in the number of the PDF we are working with and the container with the actual PDF to import. By using different reference number, we can have several scripts on the FileMaker server do several PDFs at the same time. But for FileMaker Pro, we usually have just one open. Then after we open this PDF, we can import pages from it. We can import just one page or several pages or like this, all pages. Put them in the working PDF starting at number one. And now we call the optimize command. Oops. So optimize takes a few options in the field there. And also I tell them optimize all pictures with a DPI value higher than 50 and reduce them at maximum to 150 DPI. And compress them to JPEG. I specified three times because one is for color images, one for grayscale, and one for black and white. I can use different settings there.
Color, grayscale, and
black and white. You often want a higher resolution for black and white, and maybe a lower one for colors. So, final next step, we save the PDF and also give it a name for the container, and then we clean up, we end our PDF session here. The options we have here are, for example, here to scale the images, to delete invisible paths, flatten layers, delete private data, delete thumbnails, delete alternative images. So some PDF generators put in not just a picture you see, but an alternate picture, like for CMYK pictures, they put in an RGB picture for display only, but we can nowadays just generate it on the fly in the PDF viewer, so we can reduce PDFs a lot. And if you want to see what pictures are, inside a PDF file, you can use our plugin functions for that. So this PDF contains 3 JPEG compressed images, and we even can calculate the DPI of those pictures. And FileMaker created here a PDF with 512 DPI resolution for the images, which is, in my opinion, much too much. Okay. If you have any questions or topics you'd like to show me something, yeah? Yes. We can create folders. You provide the native path on where you want the folder to be, and as long as you have permissions for the parent folder to create a new folder, the plugin will do it.
Yeah.
Well, I use your plugin a lot. I think you are missing
some of the audit functions.
The audit functions, yeah, sure. So I recently made this example here. So this is my audit log. It has a couple of entries already. Here is a test event in my events database. This is here from here. So I have here a database, and here below we show from the audit table the modifications on the table itself. So now let's say I have here Las Vegas, the venue. I commit the record. Here on the other side, I get a new entry saying the new field value is Las Vegas. And let's see, the old value here is at home. And also here in my portal, you should be able to see the modification here. It was at home before. So we can use a plugin to track modifications on a FileMaker database and write a huge audit log table with all the changes ever made. Of course, you should clear that table from time to time. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. You want to know how it works. So we go to the database definition, and here's the events table, and we added 2 fields here. The first one is a timestamp, which is automatically set by FileMaker whenever something is changed. And the second field is a calculation, which tells the plugin to run the audit function, passing in the timestamp. So FileMaker re-evaluates this every time you change a field. We have several variants of those of this function. This one is the one where I specify the list of fields I want to monitor. There's another version which is automatic mode, where we determine what fields are in the table automatically for you. Then you can specify the fields you don't want. But this is faster with a positive list. We also specify the name of the table. And we can add extra fields, like here we also record for every entry the event ID, so we can show it on the portal with a relationship. If you want to detect deletions, you have to go into security. Oh, I think it's not in this example. See this example here. So you go into security. There is your user defined. And here is for records, privilege, for deletion. And here we trigger the plugin to inform the plugin that a record is about to be deleted. And then the plugin will write the deletion into the log, yeah, and you know who deleted it. You can, there's a long list of values you can record here in the audit log. You don't need to record, to write all the fields here. We normally store the hash of the field name, the field value, table name, We can also store username, IP, timestamp, action. Well, action is create or change or delete, or the account name, window name, and a few more values are available. Yeah, that's handy. And I know at least one company which tracked a member of staff stealing stuff this way, because they saw he was modifying the number of items. So let me show you something else. The toolbar. Yes, that are all the 400 examples included. And let me show you a nice thing I made with the toolbar last year. So,
I have a question about the audit. So the tracking is done at the field level in the database engine, so no matter where the change is made,
it's based on the record.
Right.
If anything on the record is modified, FileMaker will update the timestamp. This will trigger the plugin function, and the plugin can then compare the current record to the record it saw before.
Well, what if a field is
That's a good question. I think it should work the same.
The record's not changed. I don't think the timestamp is updated.
Well, if FileMaker sees a record change and updates the timestamp,
is it updated through?
Well,
it depends on whether it's calculation.
No, no.
I'd
say I have a last name field, and
that's
changed the record to the last name field in the customer table, and now I'm in the. I'll change it.
I'm not sure. Please try.
Yeah.
Take the example, try it.
Is that on the server or?
This is on the client. We log on the client. But the database can be stored on the server, of course.
But how would FileMaker go?
No, with FileMaker go, this won't work. So, next here, something about the toolbar. I can query the configuration of the toolbar. Then I can modify it. Let's say I remove four buttons here. Oh no, here. I remove three here and say set toolbar, and just here a few buttons disappeared. You saw that? This is a nice feature to allow people to modify the toolbar when changing from one layer to different. And disable the buttons or enable the buttons they need. Okay, next thing here, we install the toolbar functions and register our own button. So now we got a new button here. We drag it in the toolbar. Of course, you can drag automatically add it with other functionality. And when we click on this toolbar button, we trigger a script.
Is this Windows as well?
No, sorry. It's a nice Mac-only feature, as well as giving the toolbar a little bit color. I have to refresh the window. Store. Hey, it's not working here. Let's try here. Ah, here it's working. So, I had a company. Well, they wanted a little bit more color in the toolbar and put the company color there. So, what's interesting for you? We have a lot of features.
What about image manipulation?
Image manipulation, yeah, sure. We have a lot of functions there. So let's say we have a picture here. We can query, of course, details about the picture, like size. We can rotate left and right. We can blur it or give it a Cole effect. We can flip it or mirror it, make a grayscale picture. We can enhance it, equalize it. We can give it a bad compression rate. We can use various effects. We can rotate it. Well, those are just effects from the framework we use. Oops, two frames.
Can you undo those selectively?
Actually, for each time you apply an effect, you can get the copy of the picture and store it somewhere in a history if you want. Or you just record yourself the commands needed to build the picture, and then you can repeat that for whenever needed. Like a couple of image editing applications nowadays just have the original picture and the list of the commands and calculate on the fly what you see. So we can also crop pictures. Yeah, sure. Can scale them. And I know a lot of people who use the plugin to make to convert any picture, for whether it's a TIFF or BMP or whatever, to a PNG. Make a thumbnail from it by reducing the size, maybe extracting values from metadata. Let's see, there was an exif. Like this picture here has a couple of values stored in the exif record, so you can query those and see which camera made the picture, for example. You can also draw things, like if you have a picture, you can draw a circle, ellipse, arc, rectangle, draw something. You can annotate a picture by putting some text on top of it, like text saying, please buy before using. You can trim white space. I don't see that. Let's see. Well, this picture has a lot of white space, and there's no white space here. Cut most of the white space. We can create an multi-TIFF files. We can also read from multi-TIFF files. Yeah.
What was the functionality that it said something to the effect of write Excel files without Excel?
Yes. We have a folder here with our Excel examples. We're using the libxl library. And let's see. I take this example and export the Excel file, open it, and this is an Excel file we just created. And to show you how it works, I open the script. So it's quite straightforward, but it's a lot of fonts and format definitions. So we start a new Excel workbook, we add a picture from a container. We add a font definition with a certain size, a name, another font definition, several font definitions. We add several format definitions. This is a format using the text font above, and left alignment, one for right alignment. Then further down, after all the format definitions, showing you all the features, we start here writing our first cell by specifying the coordinate, the text, and the format to use. And then we write a couple of more cells here.
And that's beautiful. Do you also have any abilities to parse Excel?
Yeah, we can read Excel files in the old and the new format. We can also write in the old and the new format. We can even convert between both. So let's see, we have, I think the example here, there's an Excel file, and we just press a button, and this extracts all the cells as text.
Okay.
Yeah, libxl is a C library where you need to get an additional license for. $199 per developer. So you buy it once and use it for a lot of solutions.
Now, is that Android and Dynapedia?
the Dyna PDF is for me. The Libix L, I have the links to on the website. Of course, you have to decide which license you need. So, what else? Ah, the web viewer. Well, it's very popular, especially, let's take this example here. This is a web viewer on the bottom. We loaded in an HTML editor, which is written in JavaScript and HTML. So we can fill it by using plugin functions. We can modify the text here and query back our result. This way we get an editor here. We also have, same way, a drawing tool. Initialize, draw something. We can save to a field, and we can load from a field even pictures if needed. Yes, I would use a tiny MCE to get the HTML code for the email, or you just have a template. Our plugin can send emails with HTML, with inline graphics, with attachments, as many attachments as you want. As soon as I get a plugin SDK for iOS, I will try to port all my plugin functions to iOS. Yes, if you download the plugins, you get them all. What I'm showing here is what you download. So this is, if you download it and you extract all the files from the archive, you get here the plugin files, 32-bit, 64-bit for Windows, and the plugin file for Mac, which contains both codes. You have the local documentation, and the installation guide here, telling you where to put the files, and all the examples here. And let's count .fmp12. Just 390, probably something. Yeah, let's see. Let's go one level higher because I have them in the, I moved them to the new plugin, a new example folder. So it's 429. You can try them all if you have nothing to do on the weekend. So, well, let's show you the form filling.
Christian?
Yeah?
One of my concerns is, I'm pretty sure I'm going to buy it, but I'm going to be using the product that will have to be both Windows and Mac. Is there any way to basically get the product and say, don't show me anything that's Mac only?
Well, if you go on the documentation page, you can click here on the Windows, and then you see all the functions supported on Windows. So.
Yeah, it says that it's only right next to it.
Those are the functions supported on Windows. That are the functions only for Windows. Those are the cross-platform functions, yeah.
So the cross-platform.
Yeah. Also, for every function you see, there is a little indicator here, Mac, Windows, Server. So, I'm sorry, you can't record video on server. What would you record? Someone sitting in front of the server? Okay, so if you have a form in a web viewer, like an order form, you can fill it with the plugin by having the plugin fill all the values. So I know a few people who have orders in their database and need to go to a supplier to order them. And they just load the order page from the supplier into the web viewer and then have a button to move all the order values into the form. This way you don't need to type the postal address every time. So.
Benchmarking?
Yeah, that's about asking how quick we can do that. But let's better show you the slider. The slider, here you see a nice control, that's the slider. I can move it. I can type something here and press the set button. And that's a web viewer. It uses the plugin functions to talk from JavaScript to FileMaker and from FileMaker to JavaScript. Okay, let's check something else. If you ever need a progress dialog, you can use this function here. And if it takes too long, you can cancel it or use it with a picture. So we can show progress. If you have to do something a long time, the user may appreciate if you offer a cancel button and show some progress. So,
why was that flickering?
Let's see. Because we are using script pauses. We have nothing to do here actually.
We're just too fast. Yeah.
Next thing, we have a list dialog here, where you can show a list to the user on Mac and Windows. To pick something or to pick several entries, or even with grouping, we can have two groups here and you pick something. Oh, we also have menus for, well, you can make context or menus. Most features work on Windows 2, not all. You can have submenus. When a menu is clicked, you get back the ID of the menu entry, but you can also trigger a script directly. You can have entries with images, with checkboxes, and a lot of other options. You can even define those menus with text or with XML here. So I have a menu definition to create a menu. Yeah. And some people use that for the navigation within their solution to go to all the 50 layouts they have. Yeah. We have calendar functions, yeah. Add events, reminders, and dialogues. Let's see, no, this is not the example I want. So let's see, this is nice. So we can show custom dialogues. Again, FileMaker can show dialogues, but we can show dialogues by calling a function. So you can do it in a calculation anywhere. With a let statement, you can use several MBS calls together, and you can show a dialog anywhere with a picture, with some text, some subtext, a checkbox, if you like. And you get back which button was pressed. Next, we have a couple of curl functions.
In the dialog, can you add fields with lists?
No, that was just a simple dialog from the operation system. We also had this other list dialog to pick items from a list. That's a different thing. So we allow you to download pictures from a website. You can get, that's a good thing on the curl, on curl here, we get a detailed log on what happened. So if there's any error, like missing authentication, we can figure that out. I also include a couple of web services here as example. Let's try if the weather is still working. So weather in New York is available. It's a little bit cold there compared to Las Vegas. So this is an example for using a web service, Miss Curl. So we start a curl transfer. We set a couple of options, including the URL, HTTP headers, our XML query here. And this is just the XML simply written in the script command here, and we just put in the zip code of the city we are interested in for this web service. Then we call the perform function to actually do the transfer. So we are waiting here, And then when the transfer is ready, we get the debug messages and the result. And now we figure out from the XML all the values we are interested in. Do you have any questions or comments?
Do you have anything to manage a dynamic grid? I'm having a need to develop a seating chart.
No, sorry. No grid. Yeah.
PGP encryption?
PGP, no, sorry. I know this. I have a lot of in the plugin, but they're still vicious. But I recently added RSA encryption, and that's not bad.
Licensing work? We license
a plugin for either for FileMaker Pro for seats, like 5-pack, 20-pack, 50-pack, unlimited for a company. We also offer server licenses, runtime licenses, and if you're a developer of a standard solution you give away to people, you can get a developer pro to cover all your customers. But I always recommend to try the plugin, see if it works for you. And then when you actually can make use of the plugin, we can see what license you need. Sometimes things are better running on a server, sometimes better on a client. Like for example, the barcode functions to create or detect barcodes can be used very well on an iPad even, but you would use perform script on server to run the plugin code on the server and then just show the result on the iPad. Yes, we have a discount, 20%, and you can order, well, this week, next week, just go on the website. Yeah, any other questions?
If the intention is to run the server primarily out, or run the plugin on the server, do you still have to purchase all licenses with the plugin?
If you run the script on the server, you normally buy the server license. You can, of course, have the pro developer license from us if you have 10 servers. Then it's simply cheaper to buy the big license than for each server one. No. FileMaker doesn't provide the plugins functionality through the network. So you have to install it everywhere you're using it. So if you're using the scripts locally on FileMaker Pro, you install the plugin there. We include here a little example database showing you how to install the plugin and updating it. So you have a plugin file in the database, and the script here can determine if the plugin is installed and if the version is older. And then we can install a plugin update by script if needed, or install the plugin in the first time. Other questions, wishes?
Your serial function?
We have functions for the serial port. You can list the ports on the computer. You can open one, set the baud rate, stop bits, data bits,
get,
send, get. Yeah, the plugin can execute triggers if you get data from a serial port. Also, same for a socket, or when the curl transfer in the background is finished, you can also trigger a script. We have a lot of script triggers in the plugin. Yeah. We also have OCR. So if you have some scanned pictures, well, you can scan using Twain, using our plugin. If you get the picture, you can run OCR. It should work well if you have a picture resolution of at least 150 dpi. And if you know the language in advance, it's easier. Yeah, because all the they are training files. I include with the plugin here a couple of training files. You can download more from the Tesseract website. So there's one from English here, one for German, one from French. And if you know the language in advance, it would really help to detect the right text. A couple of people use it. They use our scanning feature to put a stack of papers on a document feeder scanner. Then the scanner will, using the plugin, scan all the papers, put them in containers or files. Then we can use the OCR feature to detect any text on it, put the text in a record so you can later use full text search to find your document. We can even use our DynaPDF features to create a PDF where we overlay, let's make it red, we overlay the text we detected on the picture. This way you can select the text in the PDF and copy it while you still see the bitmap of the picture.
One question. Can I OCR a PDF file?
For a PDF file, there are different things. We can extract the PDF, the text from a PDF directly, if it's text.
Yeah.
If it's a scanned picture inside a PDF, or if the text is vector graphics, we have to actually render the PDF to a picture and then use the OCR engine. But most PDFs are just, well, have vector graphics, well, have text inside. So we can directly extract the text. So let's go to the DynaPDF examples. There's one for, so here I have example. There's a PDF inside. I can create the page count. We have two pages. Get a picture of the first page and query here the text from the first page, or extract one page as a PDF, or check what's on a page. Like this page has 287 Bezier curves. Like this helps you to see if a page is blank. So you can ask how much text is on the page, how much images, and see if the page is maybe just nothing. So we can highlight text in a PDF. So if you have a search, you search for something, let's say license, run the script, and here license is 200. So we can highlight things in a on a page. We can also compare pages.
What about secure PDFs?
We can encrypt PDFs with up to AES 256. It's the latest, I think. We can apply. We can add a password to the PDF for reading or for printing.
Can we decrypt if we have the
password? Yeah, we can decrypt too. Where is the comparison?
Can we decrypt if we don't have a password?
That could be difficult. Take some time to... Well, technically, a lot of restrictions you apply to a PDF depend on the client honoring those restrictions. So if you have a PDF application which doesn't check the print allowed flag, it will print anyway.
Yeah.
So let's say we have here a PDF, the top one is German, the bottom one is English, and we compare the content of both PDFs and highlight the things which are visually different. So this will highlight here that the headline is here in German and on the other PDF in English, so we get here some yellow colors. You can change the color if you need. yeah, we had some people who have contracts on file and want to see if the contract they sent the person and the contract they got back are the same. Except maybe the signature. So we also have an invoice example I made recently. So here we have our record for the invoice. There's a greeting line, there's a thanks line, there's an address line, invoice number, and we have here records for all the items in the invoice. We also have a template here as a PDF, so this is the the template page for the first page of our invoice containing the company details. The second page does not contain the company details, and the third page contains anything else we may want to append. So this script can create a PDF invoice. Oh, let's make one first. And this works on the server too. And a couple of customers already built solutions based on this example. So this is a PDF, currently, well, without a Dana PDF license, but it's written on the server. It uses the existing PDF as a background. So this is the first page. We put in the address and our company details. We put in the invoice number here, the table with all the stuff in the invoice listed. We calculated a sum here. On the end of the PDF, we also calculated some tax rate, some taxes. And we added the additional pages from our template file.
Christian, on the website, I think I saw something about the pricing does not include VAT, value-added tax.
Yeah, if you're in the USA, you don't have to pay European tax. Yeah.
So something they're created for.
Yes, we can create forms in a PDF.
Yeah.
90% or 90%.
By the server plugin, you still have to have the client plugins.
Depends on what you do. Yes. If you run scripts both on server and client, you need to license both.
Oh, okay. So the server plugin is just for running scripts on the server.
For scheduled scripts, for perform script on server, and for WebDirect. And for custom, for WebDirect, for custom web publishing, for perform script on server, for scheduled script.
Okay. And one other question is, the Dyna PDF is not included in the MBS?
No.
You said no?
No. That's an extra.
How much is it in the Dyna PDF?
Depends on which edition you want. It ranges from about I think $200 to $2,000, but it's something you buy per developer. So you buy it once and use it in a lot of solutions, as long as you hide the serial number, of course, so your clients don't.
Yeah. Oh, so it's used as developing.
Yeah.
Platform.
Yeah, it's a C library. It's licensed by developers, not by clients.
So you build it into your solution and then it's there for whoever uses it.
Yeah. And
for
we are
testing out, can you actually?
You can just use the plugin and Dyna PDF and libxl without a license. You are in trial mode. You can try all the features. You may see a dialogue nagging you. Yes, of course.
Can you use it in multiple solutions? Can you use it?
Well, if you install it on a server once, you can use it on all the solutions hosted on the server.
On server base?
Yeah, if you use it on the client. If you install it on the client, you can use it in all solutions opened on that client computer.
If the developer pro would cover both clients.
Yeah, the developer pro is for people selling big solutions to a lot of clients, they don't want to count how many seats they have. So, but if you have more questions, we can discuss that later. So here's the example to create forms. This is actually a script which works over table and calls Dyna PDF functions here to create a checkbox, create a text field. It has only checkbox or text field. You can also create lists and a few other controls, radio buttons. So you can create form fields on a PDF automatically in a script. You can then also use DynaPDF to query form values when you customer return user PDF, or pre-fill them by setting form fields. You call the plugin. You always call plugin function. You always call the one MBS function. And the parameter, the first parameter is the function name. And for DynaPDF, you have first tell the plugin once here for the initialization. You tell the plugin where to find the library file, which you can just put into the extension folder of FileMaker 2. But if you need help there, we can, of course, discuss that at the booth. Any more questions? Thank you for now. Come to the booth later and have a nice lunch.